research and graduate school applications.
Yeah, this is career coach 101 here. Yeah. This is like you were in it.
It's important to know that you can use those skills and not only use those, but a tip is that you can put that on your resume.
So having that connection to yourself.
Hello and welcome to CareerView Mirror. I'm your host, Joyel Crawford, and today's very special guest is Rick Gillis. Rick and I have known each other for many, many years. I think we met in 2017. It was that long ago. Rick has been in the business of employment since 1997, as employee number one, he was involved with the launch of the first local employment website to serve the greater Houston, Texas market. Leveling the Playing Field is the sum of Rick Gillis's varied and colorful career in sales as a manager, author, speaker, award-winning media host, and now as an indisputable thought leader. After more than 20 years of job search support and career advising, Rick has now created Quotient, the Quotient personal value calculation method to help workers and their employers identify and assign value to individual job performance and accomplishment in a new way. Leveling the Playing Field offers this very simple, easy to use performance metric that truly does level the playing field. The result is that not only will equal pay for equal work finally be realized, but even better, proper pay for outstanding performance will become the new normal. Welcome, Rick Gillis.
Thank you, Joyel. And excuse me for looking away. I've got dogs laying around.
That's how we do.
We're
living in this now, in the pandemic world where we've got extra furry coworkers.
right, exactly right. Thank you for that introduction. And by the way, even I still slip now and then and say leveling the playing field.
Yes.
You didn't miss it. I was impressed because sometimes I do and I just go, wait a minute, I coined this term. I know how to, and sometimes it still slips out. So good for you.
Thank you so much. Well, you know, I love a good play on words. And so I was just like, I got to practice this and make sure that I just don't jack up his book title. I'm so excited to have you on today to just share, first of all, what inspired you to write Leveling the Playing Field?
Like you said, I helped launch the first job board in 1997 in Houston, and we were very, very successful. I wasn't an owner, so I didn't share in that success. Maybe we wouldn't be here. Maybe I'd been on an island somewhere. But regardless, I spent out of that experience, I learned my own. What I learned is when I was calling on, you know, big companies, mom and pa shops, staffing companies, I was learning how job search worked. And when I was going to events to job search support, what I was hearing was not the same thing. So that got me writing books and telling people, and I got to speaking. I ended up doing this all over the country and stuff. And I've hosted radio and I hosted a small TV show here in Houston as well. And I had a lot of fun with all that stuff. But at the heart of it, when people are in job search, they're hurting. It's a really serious place to be. And I take it very, very seriously. And I've always said, I don't take, except whiners, I take no prisoners. I want my people to be very successful. And so by doing so, I required my clients, and I still do, to put together a list of their personal best accomplishments. I want, based on how long you've been working and what you're striving for, I want you to give me a list of your best accomplishments. I want you to write out for me the who, what, where, when, why, and how. And if you can, give me a valuation for that work. Mm-hmm. And the reason I require people to do this is because after you've done that, because most people are resistant to doing this, and if they won't do it, I won't work with them. But after they've done that, they're ready to now write a resume. And more importantly, they're ready to nail the interview. Because the interview is the hardest thing to do.
Yes.
All this out, and it's top of mind. And somebody says, tell me about a time when, and you just nail it. That's when they sit back and go, whoa, we got a winner here. So I will tell you candidly, the people I work with are highly successful, but I really, and listen, they do the heavy lifting. I don't, you know? So anyway, but a lot of those people that I worked, especially senior professionals, their idea of an accomplishment was on time and under budget. And I'm like, that's not an accomplishment. That's what you're supposed to be doing.
Right.
And I started requiring them to come up with a valuation. How many man hours did you save? How much revenue did you create, et cetera, et cetera. And I was astonished by how many of these people could not do it. So I started coming up with workarounds, asking them questions and trying to come up with components so we could come up with a number. Mm-hmm. That's what led to leveling the playing field, because when I came up with this number, and what happened exactly is I had an epiphany. And I mean, it was a Sunday afternoon. I was riding my bicycle. I stopped in the middle of the road on the side of the road.
Okay.
Because I saw this whole thing instantly. And what I realized and what I learned the next day by calling a friend of mine who's a retired chief financial officer is that no such measurement exists in the accounting system. And I'm like, I have a bachelor's degree. I don't have an MBA. I don't have a PhD, none of that stuff. But I just was astonished. I said, you cannot tell me the value of a paycheck worker. And it turns out you can't. In other words, a paycheck worker is anybody who's hourly or salaried. Mm-hmm. But to say that that person delivers $5,000 a week or $10,000 or $100,000 a year in value, there's no such metric.
Right.
And I came up with it. And what that is people who take a paycheck, and I call this the accomplishments mindset, they need to pay attention to what they're doing as they're doing it, because people are doing good stuff all the time. And if they're not paying attention to it, and this is not wrong, this is our system, their employer gets the benefit of all that good stuff they're doing,
yeah.
But they should be. And so anyway, so if you take the idea, the quotient model is exactly the value of your contribution to your employer, the value of what you've delivered in a year, a month, a quarter, whatever, but let's use a year. Mm-hmm. The value of your contribution to your employer divided by your base pay equals your quotient. So Joyel, let's say you and I work together, mm-hmm. and you delivered, and I'm paying you $50,000 a year, and you delivered $250,000 in value to my company. And this is something that I would teach you, and that's what the book is a lot about, is teaching mm-hmm. people how to figure this out. Mm-hmm. But I would show you how to determine the value. You came up with $250,000. Divide that by 50,000, your quotient is 5. You delivered 5 times your base pay to me as your employer, and that's a really good thing.
Yes.
The more I worked on this stuff, the more I realized, I think my highest one was I had one guy that delivered 531 times his base pay.
Whoa.
In one of my, yeah, and it was interesting because he was a construction supervisor. By the way, in the book, there's 14 what I call Q studies, and these are detailed step-by-step how I worked with 14 different people mm-hmm. to determine their quotient. So I can, and they're all different ranks and levels mm-hmm. so that you can see. But, and here's how the pay parity thing happens, because this was kind of a byproduct and a really neat thing. And I am very pro proper pay for the best performance. I believe in equal pay for equal work, but equal pay, that's really hard to measure.
Right. So,
but the proper pay for the best performance, that takes out discrimination. Regardless of what you look like, if you're the proper, the best performer, you should get the best pay.
Yes.
Let's say you and I work together. We have the same qualifications, effectively, you know, more or less. And my quotient this year was a 7. Yours was a 23. But here comes the new year, and we find out that Ricky got the promotion. I got the bonus. I got the raise. Woohoo! Yay me. And then as things are in big companies or even small companies, the word gets out that I had a quotient of 7, and my quotient is defensible. It's conservative and it's defensible. That's one of the rules of working this up. Mm-hmm. But it gets out that I had a quotient of 7. You had a quotient of 23. That means you delivered 16 times more value than I did. But because I go to work for the boss, I mean, I go to golf with the boss, mm-hmm. or I go get drinks with the boss, and you can't do that. And then let's face it, I'm mostly white and you're black. Mm-hmm. So you come on. And I'm just being candid. That's what happens every day, all the time around the world. And I don't agree with that. So you have 4 options at that point. One of them is you can go to your immediate supervisor and say, I have an issue. I want to discuss my accomplishments. Here's my quotient. I had a 27. Rick had a 7. The only problem with this, I might be your boss now. So next option is you could go to HR and say, mm-hmm. I want to file a complaint. I have an issue. It's not unreasonable for me to think this. No satisfaction. You can go to the EEOC. If that doesn't get you satisfaction, then, and I have a friend of mine who has since passed. I'm really sorry he passed, But he saw this before he passed, about a year and a half before he passed away. I actually interviewed him. His name's in the back of the book as a thank you. But he just told me, he said, Rick, this is groundbreaking. There's never been anything like this before. And I was so proud when he said that, because he was 23 years at the EEOC. And so you can go to EEOC. And if that doesn't work for you, the nuclear option is you take your accomplishments, you go find another job. And you go in with that accomplishment inventory, which is how I train people to interview.
Yeah.
And you say, here's what I did previously. Can I do this for you? That's in a nutshell what happened. And then I came up just 2 weeks before we finished editing the book. I came up with this nifty name, Leveling the Paying Field. I love that name.
Love it.
Thank you.
And you know, I mean, so you explained, and I appreciate you kind of walking our audience through the steps of like, here's what you should do in order to advocate for yourself. Cause I'm a big, you know, of course I wrote a book on advocating for yourself and showing your ask. And I think it's really important to be able to show your work and your accomplishments. What other steps would you suggest to this person kind of stepping up into their power and sharing their accomplishments with human resources or their next level supervisor?
You know what, Joyel, that's a huge question and everybody's going to be different, but here's what I will tell you. Candidly, and I've been doing this job search thing with anywhere from new grads to CEOs for 23, 24 years now. I now can candidly, categorically say people are not aware of the accomplishments they perform on a regular basis.
Oh, yeah.
And listen, if you're working today and you save the company $500, that's worth noting. To you, you may not think that's a big deal.
Right.
But are you making $500 a day? Or even if you are, it's still a big deal. Now, let's say that that $500 you just saved is because you learned how to do a process a little faster than somebody else. And somebody in your group says, hey, how are you doing that so quick? Well, let me show you. Now there's 8 people that know this. And those 8 people, pretty soon this turns into a best practice. And it's shared across 37 branches across the US. Yeah. And all of a sudden, you're saving 15 minutes turned into $300,000 or $400,000 weekly in man hours being saved, where people could finish that up quicker and get to something else. People do this all the time, and it is the basis of free enterprise, that you always continually seeking to find that better way to do something.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the regular person sitting at their computer, sitting, I don't care if they're laying floor tile, I don't care what they're doing, but if they find a better way and they share it, there should be some bonus in that.
Yes.
And you know, let me say something else too there. Sometimes people have a one-off year. Sometimes they have a huge year. Maybe it's not worth a promotion. Maybe it's not worth a raise, but it's always worth at minimum a bonus. So, you know, it's people need to, this accomplishments mindset is paying attention to what you do as you do it and annotating it as you do it.
Yes.
Put it in your email, make a note. And I do this all the time. And I go back 3 or 4 weeks, 3 or 4 months, and I look through my calendar and I go, oh, wow, I forgot all about that.
Yes.
Because we don't think about this, you know, we have other things to do. So, but in the arc, all of a sudden it turns into this big value.
Absolutely.
You're going, hey, I'm pretty good. I did that.
Yes. You know? I have a fairy god mentor who I used to work with. And her name is Wendy Wollner. And I used to call it a joy is great folder. She calls it a damn I'm great folder. And so
I like that.
I share that with all of my clients and my audiences. And I share it in the book. Have it open. Have a document. I used to have an Excel. It was bootleg. I used to have a Word document or Excel spreadsheet or good old fashioned pen and paper notebook like you're showing. Absolutely. Just write it down and just write out the accomplishments. Results-based accomplishments are what puts you ahead of the game, but you've got to understand it and study it and celebrate it. You know, Muhammad Ali says it ain't bragging if it's the truth. So
that's right. That's exactly
right. You've got to make sure that you are documenting this, because they're not documenting it. They're, you know,
Real? That's an, what you just said is a very important thing too, because I will categorically say, I'm going to be sexist right now. It's not appropriate, but I'm going to tell you the truth. Women will not speak up for themselves. That's my experience. That is not being sexist, actually. It's my experience with professional women. Here's the thing. When you're telling somebody, not just casually or actually have it written down and are identifying it, when you're sharing this information, it is informing. It is not bragging. It is not boasting. Don't think like that. It is okay to share and inform. And maybe somebody like me will be sitting back and go, wow, maybe I better pay attention to this little lady.
Yes.
Maybe I better pay attention to this little woman, you know, because damn it, that's, you know, it's, I mean, it's terrible that we have to talk like that, but it is what it is. Of course, the racial thing is still way behind. It's just all messed up.
Yes.
I don't care how good things get. It's just not right. And once again, we talked before we came on the air. You know, I mentioned Keith Weiss's new book, Diversity Is Not Enough. It's a fantastic book. And yes, he's not here to talk about it, but it's a great book. And it's true. His premise is so good. And I believe in it. I believe in the proper pay for the best performance.
Mm-hmm.
Equal pay for equal work is okay. But that was President Kennedy in 1963. And proper pay for the best performance. I had somebody challenge me. So, Rick, if all these people are doing all this great work, where are you going to get the money to pay them? And see, the paying field, leveling the paying field, the quotient is a double-edged sword. Mm-hmm. It not only shows you who your winners are, it shows you who your non-producers are. Yes. That's where the money comes from.
Yes.
When you eliminate the dead weight, all of a sudden there's a bunch of money. We can level people.
Yes. Yeah.
That's not a hard stretch.
Yeah.
And employers want this. They want the best for their bang, the best bang for their buck.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And you know, like I see how it applies to an employee, you know, speaking to the employer. What kind of tips or solutions would you give to the leader or the person receiving the information? So here it is, we're giving everyone their call to action about leveling the playing field and having the courageous, not even courageous, because it's not courage, just standing in your power and knowing your value and speaking your truth and value. So once we've had that employee come up to the employer, what tips can you give to the employer about receiving this information and leveling the playing field?
Well, number one, pay attention. Number two, understand that, like I told you earlier, let's say it was me and I saved the company $500 this week. Mm-hmm. Well, to an employer, $500 and they're dealing with a 50,000 weekly payroll or whatever, just huge numbers. It may not sound like a big deal, but it is. It is. It is a big deal. And it's relevant to the position. The other thing I'll tell you, and this was an accident, Joyel, I talked with a woman, a CEO of a company in Knoxville, Tennessee, about 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks mm-hmm. ago now. When I first came up with this concept, I was on a national panel. It was actually an international panel, and I met this woman, and she's a CEO of a small consulting company. At the time, she had 30 employees, and she so liked this idea, this quotient idea. She said, Rick, would you talk to my company? And I said, sure, that'd be fun. I've never done that before. It's brand new. Let's share it.
Mm-hmm.
And I put it out there in front of her. And so, but then, and I did about 45 minutes and some Q&A and I left it. And then I went on and we, you know, published the book and got all this stuff going on. And it struck me the other day, I said, you know, I need to call her up. Her name is Misty. And so I called up Misty and I said, Misty, are things going since you and I had that discussion? Did your employees pick it up today? She said, Rick, we're killing it. And I said, whoa, wait a minute. Now, this is a woman CEO. Mm-hmm. So I'm not concerned about the fair pay component. It's happening. Mm-hmm. But I was concerned about how are you using the quotient to advance her side of the quotient, not the employee side.
Right.
And she said, what we're doing is we're using this accomplishment inventory method. And every employee is required. And that's one of the questions I asked her. I said, mandatorily? And it's like, yeah, they can keep their job or they can go somewhere else.
Wow.
They're required to establish a projected value for everything they're doing. And they're translating that first two ways. Number one, completed assignments. They show the value. Let's say they spent $5 million. They were paid $5 million to generate $300 million in value. So they use that, first of all. There's that. Number two is each employee is required to track what they're doing. And as they submit bids, they're required to include historical information and projections on, by us doing this for you, you can anticipate this kind of revenue or value or whatever. And so anyway, what she did is, I'm going to take the Leveling the Pain Field book, and now you're the first one to hear this, I'm going to repurpose the information in that book, give it a new title, and send it out to management.
Yes.
And oh, and by the way, at the end of the book, it's going to be, instead of leveling the pain field, oh, and by the way, this methodology will also equalize fair, create fair pay. Mm-hmm. And so it's, that's going to be kind of a bonus afterthought. Nice. And I've already prepared the presentation for it to go out and start doing this, because I'm being asked to do it. So I'm coming at this now from the front end, the employees, and the yes. back end, the employers.
Yes.
And I need help, Joyel. Thank you for helping me. Thank you for letting me have this platform.
This is fantastic. I'm so excited. You know, great minds think alike. So I'm excited. I have the chills thinking about how this can not only help the employee, but the, now you're creating space for the employer, and how this can actually be more of the language that we speak in our workspace and workplaces, so that that can create parity. Now, what advice would you give? This is one of my favorite questions, because it's one of my favorite questions to ask, but if you could share one or two career pieces of advice with your younger self, with little Rick, little Ricky.
Wow.
What would they be? What would those pieces of advice be?
You know what? It's the piece of advice I give every single person now, and it's pay attention to accomplishments. Mm-hmm. It's pay attention to the little things. The little things will turn into bigger things, but it's that mindset. And you know, see, something you would know about me, something very, very few people know about me, is that I was on the road for several years doing sound. I've never been a performer as such, but I have a home recording studio. I've been playing since I was a kid, and I should have done that as a real serious hobby instead of trying to make it in that space. I was on the road for years mixing sound for bands.
Oh.
And at the same time, I was going to school, and I had more W's and incompletes than you've ever seen in a transcript. I was always going back and having to finish a class or beg forgiveness, but I finally got my degree. Mm-hmm. And so I would say, take your very serious, unless you're world-class. I mean, if you're really world-class, but if you're not world-class, don't give up your dreams ever. I'm still going to be a rock star. I just don't know when right now. But I am never going to give up my dream, but focus on the accomplishments. Take that to go out and generate revenue personally for yourself, whether you start business or just make a great living and have a great job. That's what I should have done. I should have spent a lot of years where I was dipping. I should have spent that time learning more, educating myself, even if it's a skill, because I'm a very big fan of skills. Mm-hmm. I mean, we don't have plumbers, welders, carpenters, electricians.
Right.
They can make a ton of money. And so there's that, and you can still be doing other things and put your own kids through school and advance them. So, I grew up in an old fashioned hardware store, and the first big box came to town and we were bankrupt in a year. We were gone. So, but skill sets, they don't go away.
Yeah.
There's always somebody that needs to pay you a lot of money to wire a plug or two or something. And then of course, I'm not saying anything bad about getting advanced degrees and, you know, IT and writing code and stuff.
Right.
It's the way of the world. But there's lots of ways to make a good living and still be doing what you want to be doing because you have the money mm-hmm. in your hand. I mean, I could have had a recording studio 10 years earlier if I'd have had a different skill instead of going to school part-time all that time.
Yeah. So it's like honing in. So the advice would be honing in on your skills. Don't give up on your dreams, but still hone in on those skills. And then don't give up, pay attention to your accomplishments to generate revenue. So those are the three
accomplishments. Yeah. And I'll tell you, those accomplishments also apply too. For instance, when I was mixing sound, I had accomplishments. I mixed sound for some of the biggest names in the world. But those names are not remembered anymore. You know, do you remember Buddy Miles? He played with Hendrix. He played drums. Yeah, the Buddy Miles Express, an amazing drummer, biggest, you know, but, but those things change. Those things move on. Whereas, you know, what you do today is what counts. And I really want people to be able to lay out a path.
Yes.
For their future, and more importantly, their kids, their survivors' future.
Excellent. That's great advice. Thank you, Rick.
Thank you, Joyel. It's so much a hoot to be here. And I can't wait till you and I meet one day in person. I know it's going to happen somewhere.
My mom and my soon-to-be stepfather live in Houston, Texas.
Oh, really?
Yes, they live in Spring, Texas.
Okay. And
so I am planning, you know, to get a visit out there, you know, now that things are kind of slowing down pandemic-wise, I think I'm going to make a big trip out and visit my mama. And
well, spring is a little ways from me, but you know what? I have a car and it'll get there. It'll make it there. Yes, it will. And I know how to get to spring. You betcha. That's cool.
Excellent. Excellent. So we will make that date happen. That'll be reality. But I really appreciate you coming on to share your book, your inspiration, and, you know, some really great nuggets of knowledge and tips on how people can level the playing field by advocating for themselves. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Joyel. Just remember us little folks when you get to the top, okay? Because I know you're headed there. I know you are.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Rick.
Well,
and thanks everyone for listening and watching. Like, subscribe, share with other people, and we'll see you next time on Career View Mirror. Take care.